Oil investors push up occupancy in office space. Falling coffee prices rattle Uganda farmers. Capital Markets Authority inaugurates new board. Uganda trims tourism budget. Maine prices drop as harvest season peaks. China 2022 economic growth hit by coronavirus restrictions. So there is no doubt that everyone or most of the people you speak to will tell you January is having them. It's something that we probably should have planned really, to know that after the spending in the festivities, January was definitely going to come through and times would be hard. Now, finances are not easy to come by. The bills stay constant. We have to live. But like I keep saying, if you planned, then what I'm talking about is history. Sometimes all these things, they're indicators, but we just never pay attention on how we can move. Welcome to the show. My name is Simon. Let's get you started.
We are facing a number of problems that the youths normally want to start up businesses and companies, but what challenges them is that they do lose the consistency and they also lose the patience. What happens is that when you start up, you have to be consistent and patient at the same time.
All right, so welcome to the show once again. And this week we want to talk about how to raise venture capital or venture capital mobilization in Uganda and how the regulations that are not as efficient are affecting small and medium businesses. Of course, there's no doubt that if any business was to expand, they will need a long-term kind of financing. Now, venture capital would offer a better platform because this gives a longer period before one pays back that money. Unfortunately, in Uganda, most businesses rely on banks, which again is not sustainable because of the different high rates that are charged and the limited time offered. Let's look at views from the top this week and see what a lawyer does say. If there is an amendment on some of these regulations, then the businesses would be smiling. Views from the top.
My name is Chizito Lewis. I'm a lawyer by training. For starters, there are structural bottlenecks that could lead to Uganda not raising as much capital as it would have, despite all the potential. Now, some of these structural bottlenecks are majorly legal and regulatory. Already, Uganda is raising money, despite the challenges. You find startups raising through something called a convertible note, an agreement that turns into shares in a company. You find that those agreements are many. But the reason why people in Uganda do not get venture capital beyond that stage is you find that the laws are hampering. For instance, if you look at the Capital Markets Authority Act, it assumes a venture capital fund, which is a company, which is erroneous. Because world over, venture capital funds are structured as limited liability partnerships. All they go them, if they structure them as companies, they go the Mauritius route by making them look variable companies. So a sort of company that is flexible, that can allow people move in and out of the company, taking out their capital easily. So the major bottleneck is, and if you look at the Capital Markets Authority Act, is that it stifles domestication of capital. You see, before you get other venture capital, which normally funds innovators, is raised in rounds. Now, if you do not get enough early capital, which is domestic in nature, from the local population or the local context, it will become harder for you to get exposure to the later people who give you the big monies or the big amounts, like $100 million, $1 million. Even the people who have raised the big money are Ugandan, but have had an education outside Uganda. If you look at Chipa Cash, for instance, Chipa Cash is a Ugandan, Seron Joji, that had an education in the United States. So then he could easily get exposure to early stage capital, which could propel him to other future rounds of raising capital, which is not very easy for an entrepreneur who is locally born and bred. So the structural bottlenecks have to be looked into. And I think also awareness is a problem. You have very many entrepreneurs who have not, who don't know about this form of financing. People are preoccupied with debt financing. People want to go and leverage loans or leverage collateral to get a loan because they feel they don't want to open up their company, internal company operations to an investor. So there is a cultural problem even among us entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs feel they're more comfortable getting debt because debt allows them an aura of privacy, sort of. But with this kind of venture capital, which is a form of equity financing, you have to open up your company. In other words, if you're signing a document to get this financing, the investor would want to know what is your governance, corporate governance principles, who is on your board, and some of them even demand for board seats. So you find that the people who know about this kind of financing, because they don't want to open up the business, may not want to go in for it. And then you also find that those who do not know are not willing to learn. There's a knowledge gap. And then you have the structure bottlenecks around the law. For instance, banks cannot, even when they want, they cannot provision a small percentage of their monies to help our local entrepreneurs. It should, there should be a deliberate policy by government actors to propel licensed financial institutions to at least provision a small budget of risk-to-risk capital. But now you have Capital Markets Authority coming up with, before there are regulations that were being rolled out that stakeholders not agree with. Capital Markets Authority wanted to come up with regulations that regulate venture capital. In these regulations, they proposed capital requirements, they proposed certain corporate governance frameworks that do not work well with this sort of financing. For instance, they proposed a 160 million threshold for you to start a venture capital fund in Uganda. Now, which person who is starting a venture capital fund that a Ugandan will actually accumulate 160 million? So these are, but thank God that some stakeholders in the meetings beat down some of these suggestions. And when they were beaten down, because venture capital by its very nature is risk capital. So the entrepreneur knows the risk is undertaking. It's not good for the regulator to come up with regulations that are going to stifle capital growth and capital formation. And that's what we're seeing from the regulator. So the regulator should be forward thinking. They should understand that this field before they attempt to create any sort of regulations. Most venture capital that comes into this economy is from foreign investors. We have very few local Ugandans that are funding startups through this mode of financing. There are few. You could mention them. NSSF tried to do something akin to Innovator Challenge, but there were challenges there. We discovered that some of the financing was not disbursed in full to the entrepreneurs. You find that the government, through the arms of the innovation funds, they have tried to also do this financing. But the biggest structural impediment to capital formation and domestication of venture capital is the laws, like I've stated, are bad. For instance, the reason why a person who is a Ugandan cannot domesticate venture capital and fund a business is because the tax implication on him or her is high. There's no reason why, as an investor, I will put money in a company. That is the biggest impediment. There are tax problems. What lawyers advise and have been telling entrepreneurs to do is that if someone is going to invest venture capital in your company, it's best you incorporate that company subsequently, maybe in Mauritius or in a jurisdiction that is tax friendly. So for you to convince a local investor to go and incorporate a company in Mauritius or to incorporate a company in Delaware in the US, you are stretching him so far. So it helps if the authorities at Capital Markets Authority, especially Capital Markets Authority and Ministry of Finance, look into these structural problems. Recently, they amended the Income Tax Act in 2020 to give tax reliefs to invest registered venture capital funds under Section 54, that they will not get capital gains tax if they reinvest what they earn for money investment. But the problem with that provision is that it limits the exit strategies of the entrepreneur, of the investor who is going to invest in the company. Every venture capitalist puts money in a business hoping to exit, not to reinvest to get a relief. So what we need is also seed enterprise investment schemes. When you have seed enterprise investment schemes for local businesses, is that you help the investors get robust all-round tax reliefs without cherry-picking capital gains and income tax, withholding taxes. We need a holistic framework. We need to sit down as a government, as private sector players, and have seed enterprise investment schemes for tech startups or for small businesses, because there is no economy which has grown in this world by giving tax reliefs to big businesses like MTN. That economy doesn't exist. If you look at the economies that have transformed in this world, they have transformed because they have given room for small businesses that are local to grow. That's how you see Facebook, Amazon, the Ubers, that's how they came up. The US and these other big economies just didn't be preoccupied with giving tax reliefs to McDonald's, Vivo, and Shell, because those businesses are already grown. The businesses that have the capacity to actually employ the biggest capacity of this country are small businesses that need funding. But the problem why that funding they need cannot be domesticated adequately is the tax reliefs are not there for local investors. But the foreign investors can get tax reliefs. Because like I've explained to you, for them, if I'm a US-based investor, I will just force you to incorporate a company in the US. And then whatever you have here is a subsidiary company. So whatever financing arrangements you have in venture capital end up in the other entity of the US, which is going to be used as a financing investment vehicle into your local business. So, but for the local entrepreneur, the taxes will be overwhelming. You will pay capital gains tax, then you will pay all these local service taxes. So even when you're going to dispose of your investment and sell it off to us at a profit, they will tax that capital gains. If the shares you're going to dispose of, you're going to sell them at a higher value than you attain them as an entrepreneur. For instance, venture capital, you have to pay capital gains. But again, they created an amendment, like I told you, in 2020, which gives them reliefs. But that amendment doesn't go far enough, because it tells you as an entrepreneur that you can only get tax reliefs if you reinvest a portion of whatever benefits you have benefited to get a 50% relief. So as an entrepreneur, you would rather not utilize that. So the domestication of venture capital goes down to the taxation and then the legal regulatory regime. A capital markets authority have this preoccupation that a venture capital fund is supposed to be a company, which is wrong. World over, venture capital funds are structured as limited liability partnership for ease of business, so that the venture capital fund can mobilize capital easily. Because if you're a limited liability partnership, you can easily get limited partners to invest.
So I guess that kind of just resonates with what the Minister of State for Finance and Planning, Amos Lugolobi, did state during the week at the inauguration of a new board for Capital Markets Authority. And he did say it's important that businesses look into long-term financing, and that is by listing or issuing bonds on the capital markets. This would just shield them off a bit the pressure from the banks that are charging higher rates but also want their money paid back in less time. Of course, we know that with the uncertainties and the instability generally, or economic upheavals, it's important that if a business is taking money, if let's say financing for long term, it should be something within the range of 5 or 10 years. So if you're going to rely on banks to do that, it might not work for you. So we can only hope that there are some amendments made and the businesses can get the venture capital arranged in the country and improve or grow generally in 2023. My name is Simon. Thank you for staying with us. We're taking a quick break. Feel free to get in touch with us. Don't go so far away. I'll see you shortly.